Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha, and in today's video we will discuss the next problem under aesthetics, gummy smile or excessive gingival display. Again, we will discuss this topic in multiple videos. That is, for today's video we will discuss the terminology, classification and pre-treatment evaluation or diagnosing the case and etiology. And in the next videos, we will discuss the treatment options for the same. So for today's video, we'll begin with the terminology. Gummy smile means gums are visible during smile. So that means gums shouldn't be visible during a smile. So for that, we will first discuss what is a normal smile or how much of the gums display is acceptable as pleasant or how much of the gums display is considered as unpleasant. We will discuss first these few points followed by the classification of excessive gingival display, EGD, excessive gingival display. So for smile, again various classifications, but a very common one is low, average or normal and high. So low means less than 75% of clinical crowns are visible, just crowns, there is no question of gums here. So low smile line means less than 75% of the clinical crowns are visible during smile. Average or normal means 75 to 100% of the crown visible plus interdental papilla visible. Please note, interdental papilla visible. And high smile line is where all the clinical crowns plus continuous band of gingiva, continuous band. So this is high smile line, and this is where the problem begins. With the low and average, because average is also called normals, that means this low and average is not a problem. The term itself says normal, means normal, no problem. The problem is with high smile line where there is a continuous band visibility. So now the question is, dimension of this band, how much of this band display is acceptable as aesthetically acceptable or pleasant and aesthetically unacceptable or unpleasant. Please note, we are not contradicting this with any of the excessive gingival display discussion. Of course, this high smile line is a case of excessive gingival display. But under excessive gingival display, we have certain threshold value which is acceptable as aesthetically pleasant or not a problem aesthetically. So every case of excessive gingival display is not meant for treatment. There is a threshold value of gingival display which is considered to be, I'm not saying normal, it is of course not normal, but some value of gingival display is considered to be aesthetically acceptable. It is definitely a case of excessive gingival display, but it is aesthetically acceptable, so it does not require treatment. And that dimension, of course, it varies from author to author. Various authors have various opinions, but there is one opinion which was accepted widely, that is, only 1 mm of gingival display, up to 1 mm of gingival display is considered aesthetically acceptable. Although a case of excessive gingival display or gummy smile, because gums are visible during smile, but still 1 mm is accepted as from aesthetic point of view to be acceptable. Otherwise, if it is more than 1 mm, it is a definitely requiring a treatment. It definitely calls for some type of treatment. So till now we have discussed the terminology, the types of smile and the threshold value of acceptable aesthetics. Now we will discuss the classification of excessive gingival display. Please don't get confused. We just discussed the classification of smile. Now we will discuss the classification of EGD. Now with EGD, excessive gingival display, there are various classifications, but one such classification which we are going to discuss I personally prefer to follow this classification. Please note, it is not given in any of the standard textbooks, but it is definitely from one of the standard reference journals. I am sure the postgraduates and the practitioners must have heard of the journal, International Journal of Periodontics Restorative Dentistry, IJPRD. 2015, Monish Gola et al. They gave classification of EGD based on etiology. Means we have added advantage of discussing the etiology simultaneously, and that is why I personally prefer to discuss this classification particularly, wherein we have the classification with the etiology simultaneously. So it is for me, I feel it is an all-inclusive or an extensive classification to understand the case of excessive gingival display. And then bonus, based on this classification, we are also able to do the pre-treatment evaluation of the case, that is diagnosing the etiology of the case. Clear? So let's begin with the classification. I have attached the download link for this classification article as well as my notes for your reference and easy understanding respectively. So please refer the description box below for both the links, one link for the notes that I provide regularly and one for this original article, so that you can refer for your personal understanding and preferences. Clear? Now, and one more additional point with this classification gives us a mnemonic as well. The mnemonic is ABCDE. The categories are EGD A, B, C, D and E. A for altered passive eruption, B for bony maxillary excess, C for conditions causing gingival enlargement, D for deficit maxillary lip length, and E for excessive mobility of maxillary lip. So, with this classification, we have classification, we have the etiologies, we have the mnemonic as well. So these are the various advantages of discussing this classification. Now we will discuss each category in detail. So EGD A, A for altered passive eruption. What is altered passive eruption? It is the clinically shorter crowns appearing. Clinically shorter crowns because the gingival margin failed to migrate apically to the CEJ, and that is why the crowns, the clinical crowns, there are two types of crowns, anatomic crown and clinical crown. Anatomic crown is same, but the clinical crown is short because, see, this is the anatomic crown and here is the gingival margin. So this gingival margin should have migrated little apically to its position to maintain that sulcus depth between, that is CEJ and the free gingival margin. Usually the sulcus depth is somewhere, the base of the sulcus is at CEJ, 1 mm apical to the CEJ. So to maintain that normal probing depth, normal sulcus depth, this free gingival margin should have migrated more apically so that the crown length would have appeared normal. But because this free gingival margin did not migrate apically towards the CEJ so as to maintain the sulcus depth and the clinical crown length, that is why we have short crowns and greater probing depth. These are the two problems with this case of altered passive eruption. The main problem is short crown because the free gingival margin failed to migrate apically, thereby leading to shorter crowns and greater probing depths. So here the evaluating factor is the clinical measurements of the clinical crown. Everything clinical. For EGDA, evaluate the length of the crowns. So again there will be two answers, yes or no. If they are normal, EGDA is ruled out. But if they are not normal, no, they are shorter, then it is a case of EGDA. That is, it is a case of altered passive eruption. Now here ends the diagnosis of EGDA. Further categorization is to choose the treatment plan. That is, we have subclass or subtype, type A and B. Type A is where keratinized tissue is adequate or more, and type B is where keratinized tissue is less or narrow. That means width of gingiva, not just attached gingiva, it is keratinized, means both marginal and attached gingiva, and location of mucogingival junction is apical to bony crest. Clear? This is subtype A, and here mucogingival junction is somewhere near to CEJ. So this is the subtype A and B. Please note, our diagnosis of EGDA ends with the appearance of shorter crowns and associated with greater probing depths. But to understand the further which treatment will be applicable onto the case, we have to evaluate two main parameters: width of the keratinized tissue and locating the mucogingival junction, plus the second parameter, distance between CEJ and the bony crest. These two parameters. If this is our gingival margin, this is CEJ, and the bony crest, let's say here. Okay, so now subtype A is where we have adequate keratinized tissue and mucogingival junction is apical to the bony crest. So mucogingival junction is somewhere here. That means the keratinized tissue width is this much. Whereas conversely, if this is our gingival margin with APE, this is the CEJ and the bony crest is here and the mucogingival junction is also here, means we have less keratinized tissue. Clear? So this is subtype A and subtype B. Now where we have adequate keratinized tissue, we have an opportunity, we have an option of choosing a treatment plan or a surgical technique which involves excision or resection of the marginal tissue. One such technique is for subtype A is gingivectomy. That is external bevel gingivectomy. If we have adequate keratinized tissue, plus I told you there are two parameters to consider. One is the keratinized tissue width. Please refer to my separate videos on identification of mucogingival junction and assessment of the width of attached gingiva, which we have discussed previously. If you want, you may refer to those videos, and that will be able, that will help you to understand the topic more better. So under subtype A, where the keratinized tissue is adequate and mucogingival junction is apical to bony crest, we have an opportunity to resect the marginal tissue so as to give better contours to the newly forming gingiva there. Clear? But we have two parameters to assess. One is the keratinized tissue width. Second parameter, which will divide them into type 1 and type 2 respectively, is the distance between CEJ and bone. If this distance is more, that means, that is more than or equal to 2 mm, if this distance between CEJ and bone, that is bony crest, is located farther, then we can resect the only soft tissue, because then it will not encroach onto the biological width. I hope the biological width concept is very clear to all of you, because that is a very important concept. We should not encroach or violate the biologic width, otherwise it will lead to further problems. That is why to adjust the biologic width, we have to do soft tissue resection and hard tissue resection. But if the distances are favorable, then only soft tissue resection by gingivectomy is advisable. That is type 1, where the distance between CEJ and bony crest is adequate. then only soft tissue resection by gingivectomy should be sufficient. Here we will do gingivectomy. But even though the keratinous tissue is adequate, but let's say this bony crest is nearer, then in such case, if we resect the tissue, then the biologic width will be violated. So to adjust that biologic width, we also have to shift the hard tissue margin apically, shift the entire complex apically. So we have to perform flap plus osseous reduction. So wherever the distance between CEJ and bony crest is less, in such cases, to achieve adequate crown lengthening, both soft tissue and hard tissue has to be resected. But in cases where keratinized tissue is adequate, but the distance is inadequate between the CEJ and the bony crest, then we have to do flap plus osseous resection. I hope you are getting the concept. I repeat once again, we are still on subtype A, where soft tissue width is adequate. Now, soft tissue width is adequate. Now we have to evaluate the distance between CEJ and bone. If the distance between CEJ and bone is adequate, then only soft tissue resection will work. But if the distance between CEJ and bone is inadequate, that is less, in that case, only soft tissue resection won't work. We have to perform soft tissue resection plus hard tissue resection, that is osseous reduction. Clear now? I hope so. This is subtype A. Now we will talk about where there is inadequate keratinized gingiva. Now, with inadequate keratinized gingiva, soft tissue resection is out of option now. So now we are left out with only hard tissue resection. But then hard tissue resection will also require some type of surgical technique to at least elevate the flap. And when we already have narrow width of keratinized gingiva, we should also perform a surgical technique which will give us an added benefit of increasing the width of attached gingiva. And that technique is none other than apically positioned flap, which we have discussed in a separate video during discussion of periodontal flap surgical technique and recently during discussing this chapter, periodontal plastic and aesthetic surgery, techniques to increase the width of attached gingiva. So, if the keratinized tissue width is narrow and the distance between them, but then the distance between CEJ and bone is adequate, then it does not require osseous reduction. We can manage with only apically positioned flap. And if with narrow keratinized gingiva, the distance between CEJ and bone is inadequate, that is less, then we have to do osseous reduction in combination with apically positioned flap. So, two simple concepts. If the tissue is adequate, soft tissue width, that is keratinized tissue width is adequate, we have an option of soft tissue resection. So, for subtype A, we can perform gingivectomy. But for subtype B, where soft tissue, that is keratinized tissue, is inadequate, we cannot perform gingivectomy. We have to perform something which will also provide increase in the width of attached gingiva, so apically positioned flap. Now, under the subtypes, under these two subtypes, we have type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is where the distance between CEJ and bone is adequate, that is bone is located farther from CEJ. So there only soft tissue manipulation will work and biologic width is not endangered. So for subtype A, gingivectomy, and subtype B, type 1, apically positioned flap. But type 2, in both the cases where the distance between CEJ and bone is less, that means if we do soft tissue manipulation, that is we shift the soft tissue margin apically, then we will encroach onto the biologic width, and that is why the hard tissue margin should also be shifted apically by doing osseous reduction. It is this simple concept, and I really hope this is clear to you all. But if you still find it difficult, no worries. You can ask me in the comment section below or onto my Facebook Messenger, Instagram, and I will discuss this once again. Not once again, I will discuss it again and again until you understand it. I assure you that. So for now, EGD A is complete. EGD A for altered passive eruption. Clinical evaluation is the length of the crowns. If they are shorter, it is a case of EGD A, wherein we have subtype A and B and further types 1, 2, 1, 2, and their respective treatment plans. So this completes EGD A. Now we will discuss EGD B. EGD B, B stands for bony maxillary access. So for that we have to evaluate extraoral facial examination. EGD B, B for bony maxillary access. So please refer the textbook of orthodontics particularly to understand this extraoral examination. The roughly speaking, the face is divided into equal thirds, that is somewhere from the forehead point to glabella, glabella to subnasally, and subnasally to the undersurface or inferior border of the chin. These three, this face is divided into these thirds, one third, one third and one third. And if these three are equal, that means it is normal, okay? This is normal. But if this lower third from subnasally to the inferior border of chin, if this is greater, this lower third portion is found to be greater, then it is a case of bony maxillary access. So for EGDB, evaluating factor is the facial examination by dividing them into the equal thirds, and if this lower third is found to be greater, then it is a case of BME. Now in bony maxillary access, why excessive gingival display? Because the teeth are located farther from the base of their skeleton, the maxillary skeleton. The teeth are located farther from the skeletal base, and that is why gums are displayed more during the smile of patients or case with bony maxillary access. So only evaluating factor is the facial examination by dividing them into the equal thirds. Refer to the textbook of orthodontics. I will suggest you to read a textbook of orthodontics, Gurkirat Singh, for case history and diagnosis particularly. That one chapter is very beautifully described in that textbook of orthodontics, Gurkirat Singh. And it's easily available on Google. You will definitely get a download link for the same. If you don't get it, do let me know. I will provide you the download link in the description below next time. So this is EGDB. Now what is the treatment for BME? Again, this treatment depends on the degree of gingival display. Of course, it is a case of gingival display associated with BME, bony maxillary access, but how much display? So degree 1 is 2 to 4 mm, 4 to 8 mm is degree 2, and greater than 8 mm is degree 3. So if it is 2 to 4 mm, we have aesthetic crown lengthening procedure. Please note, crown lengthening are of two types, aesthetic and functional. Do let me know if you want me to discuss crown lengthening as well. There are two types of crown lengthening, aesthetic and functional, based on why we want to perform crown lengthening, not based on the techniques of crown. There are many techniques of crown lengthening, but why we want to perform crown lengthening has two types. Aesthetic, that is for aesthetic purpose, gummy smile. Functional means for any restorative or prosthetic purpose. Okay, so here under BME, for 2 to 4 mm of display, we have the options of aesthetic crown lengthening. We have a lip stabilization technique, that is lip stat, or even orthodontic intrusion. Because the crown lengths are adequate, but still there is some amount of gummy smile. So orthodontic intrusion. Now 4 to 8 mm, again we have the option of lip stat. Lip stat is a lip stabilization procedure which involves a resection of alveolar mucosa. So again, lip stat means it is lip stat with more amount of alveolar mucosa resection. Okay. And the next option for 4 to 8 mm is orthognathic surgery. BME is a case for orthognathic surgery, but if the degree is 2 to 4 mm or 4 to mm, we have other options. But if it is greater than 8 mm, the definitive treatment plan is orthognathic surgery. I hope EGDB is clear to you all. The evaluating factor is the facial thirds, and if the lower third is found out to be greater, that is subnasally to the inferior base, inferior border or the undersurface of chin is greater than the other thirds, then it is a case of BME. Again, subtypes, degree based on the amount of gingival display and their respective treatment options. With this EGDB bony maxillary axis is complete. Now we will discuss EGDC. C for conditions causing gingival enlargement. EGDC. Conditions causing gingival enlargement. Now here the evaluating factors is the gingival enlargement, especially contour, consistency and size. So gingival examination, the periodontist or periodontics PG will relate to this gingival examination. I'm sure UG undergraduates will also know this. There are multiple entities to be examined under gingiva, soft tissue examination gingiva: color, contour, consistency, shape, size, surface texture, position of the gingival margin, bleeding on probing, exudates. So contour, consistency and size are to be measured particularly, has to be examined, and if they are found to be normal then EGDC is ruled out. But if they are abnormal, altered, then we have to find out why. Then we have to find out what is the reason behind these alterations, what is the reason behind these abnormalities. So as we all know, gingival enlargement has multiple causes, multiple reasons. So based on the reasons, we have the treatment. If it is plaque or any plaque retentive factor, we have phase 1 therapy. Or elimination of the retentive factors, let's say some restorative margins discrepancy or any prosthetic contours are not correct or incorrect, so they are leading to retention. Any orthodontic equipments inside, clear? So all those factors, retentive factors, have to be eliminated. If it is purely local factors, then like inflammatory gingival enlargement, phase 1 therapy should be the treatment. If it is medicines, so again, for EGDC, along with this gingival examination, the thorough case history, particularly medical history and drug history, should be noted. Both together, both combined together, will give us an idea whether it is medicines related, drug induced gingival enlargement. If it is so, we have to make a referral to the consulting physician, supervising physician, to evaluate the medical status and do the drug supplement substitution. And if it is any hereditary, like gingival fibromatosis or some sort of enlargement which is hereditary in origin, we have to plan surgery, that is gingivectomy followed by gingivoplasty. Clear? EGDC, very simple. Conditions causing gingival enlargement, evaluation is intraoral evaluation of the gingiva and medical and drug history, particularly, of course entire case history, but particularly medical and drug history, which will give us an idea why are they not normal, what is the reason, and the reason will give us the answer of what to do, how to treat. So this is all about EGDC, conditions causing gingival enlargement. See, this is a really interesting classification because we are able to discuss the etiology as well, and plus a bonus benefit of a mnemonic ABCDE. So now we are discussing EGDD, deficit maxillary lip length. So here again the evaluating factor is lip length. Lip length normal 22 mm plus minus 2 mm for males and 20 mm plus minus 2 mm for females. I have referred this value from textbook of oral and maxillofacial surgery by Balaji. Don't get confused with the author Balaji for textbook of orthodontics. They are two separate textbooks. So I have referred the value of normal lip length from textbook of oral and maxillofacial surgery by Balaji. So this is the normal lip length. Lip length is measured from subnasally to the inferior border of upper lip, that is stomion, upper lip stomion. Clear? If that value is again normal, means it is not a case of EGDD. But if it is short, that is less value, then it is a case of EGDD. And the treatment is lip training. Lip training exercises. As simple as that. Just measure the lip length from subnasally to the upper lip stomion or the inferior border of the upper lip, If it is normal, it is not the case of EGDD, but if it is short, it is a case of deficit maxillary lip length EGDD, and the treatment is lip training exercises. Clear? Now we will discuss the last category, EGDE, and then we will discuss how to evaluate the case of excessive gingival display. EGDE, E stands for excessive mobility of upper lip, maxillary lip, excessive mobility of upper lip or maxillary lip. So here the evaluating factor, this is an interesting entity. Now we will discuss, there are two types of smile, please don't get confused. First we discuss the types of smiles based on the display of the gums and teeth. But two types of smiles are purely what we perform. It is not based on any display or any entities associated with. The two types of smile are, first is static smile, second is dynamic smile. Static smile is something which we give during passport size photographs, during giving any pose, which is not wholehearted, just for sake of giving a smile, social smile. Yes, that is static smile, which is not wholehearted. You just give it for sake of giving. And dynamic smile is our true smile, where we laugh with our full emotions, we laugh our heart out and full totally, and it is with full emotions. So that is dynamic smile. Now between these two smile, the smile line translates. And that translation, that difference between static smile and dynamic smile is somewhere 6 to 8 mm. But in some cases, it is excessive, 1.5 to 2 times also, double. And that is not acceptable. And that is where EGDE comes into the picture. That excessive mobility of upper lip, excessive mobility of maxillary lip, the more difference between these two smile is because of the hyperfunction of our labial elevator muscles, and that is a problem. So this excessive translation has again classification depending on the amount of gingival display. Now that amount of gingival display, if it is 1 to 3 mm, 4 to 6 mm and greater than or equal to 7 mm. So here the treatment varies again. If it is 1 to 3, treatment is lip stabilization in all the three cases. I told you lip stabilization technique involves removal of mucosa, alveolar mucosa. So here LipStat will lead to removal of mucosa somewhere around 5 mm. Here it will be 8 to 10 mm. And here it will be 12 to 15 mm. So as to stabilize the lip, excessive mobility of the upper lip. Clear? So this is how EGDE is treated by LipStat, a lip stabilization technique based on the degree amount of gingival display during the translation. If the translation between static and dynamic smile is more, if normally acceptable is 6 to 8 mm, if it is more than that, almost a double, then it is termed as excessive mobility or hypermobility of maxillary lip associated due to hyperfunction of the labial elevator muscles. So here we complete the classification of EGD. Till now we discussed the terminology, types of smile, and now types of EGD. This is just one classification. I am sure there are many, but this is one classification which I feel is all inclusive. Particularly, my personal opinion, your opinion may definitely vary, and I wholeheartedly accept your opinion as well. Do let me know if you want me to discuss any other classification or any other literature associated with gummy smile. All the queries are welcome. So here is the end of the classification of EGD. Now based on this classification, we will discuss the final and the most interesting part of today's video, how to evaluate the case of gummy smile. That is, let's see, if we have a patient of gummy smile, we have to choose what treatment we will give to the patient. Now just as we discussed, based on etiology, the treatment varies. So simply by seeing gummy smile, we cannot discuss, we cannot decide like let's do crown lengthening or let's do orthognathic surgery. It sounds so illogical, right? So we have to do some systematic evaluation. So that systematic evaluation is, first is extraorally. As the patient comes, we will first do extraorally the two smiles, static and dynamic smile. Clear? And here we will be able to evaluate whether it is EGD E or not. Then we will proceed to intraoral, that is crown measurements, crown's length particularly, to evaluate whether it is a case of EGD A or not, that is altered passive eruption. And again intraorally, if it is yes, if it is shorter crown length, we have to measure the keratinized tissue and the distance between CEJ to the bone and the mucogingival junction to assess the treatment plan accordingly. And again further intraorally, we have to do the gingival examination and plus above all case history, that is medical and drug history, to find out if it is a case of EGD C. Once this is done, then we have to come out again extraorally. We have to do facial examination, that is thirds, to find out if it is EGD B. And lastly, we have to do again extraorally lip length measurement to find out if it is EGD D. As simple as that. So this is how we evaluate the case of excessive gingival display or gummy smile. First is the static and dynamic smile translation. Intraorally, crown length measurement and the keratinized tissue, distance between bone and CEJ, and the contours, consistency and size, particularly under gingival examination. Medical history, particularly to rule out drug induced gingival enlargement. Facial examination, that is dividing them into the thirds, and lip length. So this is how a case with excessive gingival display should be evaluated to arrive at a diagnosis with etiology. This is the added advantage of following this classification particularly, because we will not just diagnose the case, but we will also diagnose the etiology. And because we will be able to diagnose the etiology, we will be able to formulate an accurate treatment plan. And that is where our success lies. Just diagnosing or evaluating the case is not the only matter of the story. The actual story begins after diagnosing the case. So here, because with the diagnosis and because with the diagnosis, we also have identified the etiology, we will be able to frame an appropriate treatment plan and execute it thoroughly also. So this is how we evaluate the case of excessive gingival display. I hope the entire matter of today's video is clear to you all. I know it is really difficult, but I have tried my level best to simplify it and present it to you. We have discussed the terminology, types of smile, that is low, average and high smile. Classification of excessive gingival display, normally accepted gingival display of 1 mm, and now greater is anesthetic, like aesthetically unpleasant. So classification of gingival display by Monish Bhola et al. 2015 from IGPRD. Classification as categories EGD A, B, C, D, E. A for altered passive eruption, B for bony maxillary excess, C for conditions causing gingival enlargement, D for deficit maxillary lip length, and E for excessive mobility of lip length, followed by pre-treatment evaluation of the case. I hope the topic is clear to you all, but if you still have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me in the comment section below or mail it to my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com, or ask me on Facebook, Messenger, Instagram, and I will definitely reply to all of your queries, and I will also discuss all the requested topics once this topic is completed. We are a few videos away from discussing the requested topic, so please be patient with me, and until then, keep studying. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well, have a good day, stay safe.